Hello everyone and welcome back to the channel. And if you are in my class, welcome back to the lecture. So today we're going to talk about the final section or the last section of robot kinematics, which is specifically trajectory planning. In the past few weeks or nearly in the last month, we were talking about robot kinematics and we were focusing on the relationship between robot joints and robot configuration. Basically, in inverse kinematics, we were focusing on this situation, which is given the position and orientation of the robot, given the position and orientation of the end effector, what will be the required angles to achieve this particular position? And in forward kinematics, it was the other way around. It was essentially given the, what is that? Yeah, given this, basically it was the opposite. Given in forward kinematics, given the values of the individual joints, then what will be the corresponding robot position and the position orientation of the end effector? It's like too conflicting. But in all of these cases, we were always dealing with a specific individual position or a joint. And trajectory planning is about something else. It is about what happens in between points. So let's see what that means, really. So here's a table of contents for today's session. Today's session is, or this particular session is relatively small compared to the other sections because the heavy parts, you can say, the heavy duty stuff, we've already covered through forward and inverse kinematics. But trajectory planning is, relatively speaking, smaller. So what I'm going to talk about is essentially some definitions like path versus trajectory, joint space, Cartesian space, and then the basics of trajectory planning. What is it all about? And then we're going to talk about trajectory planning using polynomials and how or why they are useful for us. And if this sounds familiar, if you are coming from the mechanical engineering courses, and if this sounds familiar to you, then good, because whatever you're thinking about, it's correct. But we'll get to that in a minute. So a little bit of introduction. What is trajectory planning? So let's take a look at this robot right here at its current configuration. When you see the current shape of this robot or the way that it looks like right now, we call it a robot configuration. So at this configuration, AKA at this exact values of theta 1 and theta 2 and theta 3, so we call this current configuration. Now here's the same robot, but at a different configuration. And this is important. You see, now the shape of the robot is different. Its reach, the orientation of the end effector is totally different. And that's what we refer by configuration. See, this is one configuration, and this is a second configuration. So trajectory planning is about how does the robot travel from one configuration to the other. We can do forward kinematics here, like, okay, if I give you the values of theta 1, theta 2, and theta 3, then what will be the corresponding pose of the end effector? Or we could do inverse kinematics here. We can basically, if I give you the pose of the end effector, then you would need to find out the corresponding values of theta 1 and theta 2 and theta 3, all right? No problem. We can do the same things here. You know, we can do forward and inverse kinematics again on this configuration. But the trick is, or the situation now is, what happens in between? When the robot travels between the two configurations, how does the robot actually change or travel? So this is the study of inverse kinematics. This is the study of trajectory planning. It involves kinematics as well as kinetics. Kinematics basically means position and orientation and acceleration. Position, velocity, and acceleration. But kinetics will also involve dynamics or forces and torques. So let's a little bit more of definition. So a trajectory versus a path. What is the difference between these two words? They might appear similar to them in a regular layman language, but specifically in industrial robots, they actually mean different. They have a different meaning. So let's talk about what is a path. The English word path might have a different meaning to you right now. So I want you to put that aside and focus on this particular definition of a robot path. For industrial robots. So a robot path, when it comes to industrial robots, is a sequence of robot configurations, as you can see from here. So this is one configuration, this is another configuration, and this is another configuration. So a sequence of all of these configurations are all considered, this is all basically considered a robot path. And they are in particular order, so you don't jump from this configuration to this one and this one. No, they are actually given in this correct order. But we ignore the timing of this configuration. Basically, what does that mean? You can say that the amount of time to go from this configuration to this configuration could be 1 second. But to go from the second to the third configuration, this might be 3 seconds. And so on and so forth. And so we actually don't care. When we talk about robot path, we do not care about timing. We ignore it. You know what I mean? So basically, we're going to assume that all the transitions happen at constant speeds. In other words, when you transfer or when you transition from one configuration to the other, like this, the duration in between is constant, or at least we don't care about it. Now, the word robot path might seem, or even the word path in general, right, might actually mean something else to you. And this has to do with, when you're driving a car, or even in mobile robotics. A robot path obviously is the journey or the line that defines the actual movement steps from one point to another. So you can see that this green line right here is a navigation path of this robot. So this is the word path in mobile robotics. But believe it or not, this path is also defined using exactly the same definition that we said earlier. It's a sequence of robot configurations. So this is one configuration. Here is another configuration, which is right here. And here's another configuration. So once again, a sequence of configuration. Now in this configuration, the robot position and orientation changes. See, this is the position, and this is the orientation. Position, orientation, and so on. So although it looks different, but it's actually is exactly the same meaning. A robot path, whether it's mobile robot or industrial robot, is a sequence of robot configurations, or aka changes in position or orientation, or robot parameters along the path. Of course, in mobile robotics, this means traveling along the path, which is part of the robot navigation package, avoiding obstacles, going from A to B, etc. So we're going to focus on, we're going to ignore for a second the mobile robotics definitions. We're going to focus on industrial robots, because this is our course, focuses entirely on industrial robots. So now let's talk about the robot trajectory. Just now we discussed the path, but now let's talk about trajectory. A trajectory is very similar to robot path. It's exactly the same meaning. It's a sequence of configuration that are actually changing. However, we now incorporate the timing. We must incorporate the timing, otherwise we're gonna have problems. So therefore, the robot's velocity and acceleration, as well as dynamics, are all incorporated. Meaning, incorporated means that we put into consideration, we will study the effects, and therefore we will have a note in mind what happens to robot kinematics, what happens to robot dynamics as it moves from one configuration to another. So essentially, a trajectory is a robot path plus timing. So you can simply say, if you want, you can just down here and say trajectory is equal to path plus timing of the changes, or timing of the changing of the configuration. Okay, this is a horrible way of writing, but bear with me. So what's the big deal? Why do we have to consider timing to begin with? You see, if you don't consider timing, then you might end up with unplanned changes in velocity and acceleration. And this is actually the key one right here. If you remember in Theory of Machine, we've seen something like this as well. If you have unplanned changes in velocities and acceleration, then you will have terrible consequences. If you end up with very high values of acceleration, you know what? I'll give you a moment to think about this. What happens if you get acceleration, whether it's A acceleration or alpha for angular, which is very, very high? What's the big deal? And what about velocities? If velocities itself is also very high, so if V for linear or omega for angular, if that one is also very high, what's the big deal? Think about it for a minute, and then You can pause if you want. Think about it for a minute and come back to this video. Okay, so I hope you have figured it out. This one might be a little bit easier to realize, which is the effect of the acceleration. Obviously, the acceleration have a direct effect, which is force is equal to m, which is the mass multiplied by acceleration. So if you have a high acceleration multiplied by the object's mass, you will end up with very high forces. The same thing applies for angular. If you have a torque is simply equal to the inertia multiplied by the angular acceleration. So the angular acceleration, if it's too high, you will end up with very high torque. And if you have very high torques, then those torques will be applied on the motors. So those motors moving the robot into this or these joints right here, they will have to apply extremely high torques that could result in damaging the motors or the actuators. So if you are not careful, you could end up applying amounts of torques and forces that are beyond the capacity of the actuators. Or you would require then, in this case, very high amount of torques, which would require a huge amount of motors, which will become very difficult to work with. So whatever it is, you will always want to end up, you will always want to reduce the amount of accelerations in order, or at least control it within the limits of the actuator's capabilities. Okay, that was the acceleration, but what about the velocities? Well, velocities, if you remember, are involved directly in kinetic energy. So Ke, kinetic energy, is simply equal to half of mv squared, also equal to half of I alpha square, which is the inertia and alpha, which is, this is the linear and kinetic, and this is the angular kinetic. So once again, if the, sorry, not alpha, omega, apologies. So let me just clarify it. So this is omega square, yeah, not alpha square. So even though we are not talking about acceleration yet, we're only talking about velocities, you could end up with a very high kinetic energy. And again, if the kinetic energy is too high, then we are talking about consumptions of power, you know, even though, let's say that we ended up with a, even though that we had an acceleration that is within the capacity of the actuator, okay, no problem here, but then we still end up with unnecessarily high amounts of velocities, you can end up with kinetic energy, and kinetic energy or energy in general are directly connected to the power, which is energy divided by time, and therefore that could actually result in amount of power required to move the robot. So you could end up with unnecessarily amount of power consumptions or amount of power required to move the robot, which again, power is translated to costs, which again could result in unnecessarily powers or unnecessarily power costs involved in the robot operations. So if you're having an industrial robot doing machining or let's say welding, but you're overusing the amount of power, electrical power to run the robot, then a lot of the overhead costs will go to just moving the robot. That will actually increase the cost of the product, will minimize your profit margin, and cause other problems. So you would always want to minimize these two together. As much as possible, lower the velocities as much as possible, and of course, lower the acceleration. So that is why this is the importance of trajectory planning and so on. Okay, all right. We get that. What's next? So now let's just define one more definition, which is joint space and Cartesian space. And this terminology is used in many robotics books. I would like you to take a look at this and familiarize yourself with it. You are already familiar with this concept. I just want you to be familiarized with the name of it. So what is joint space? Joint space trajectory or Cartesian space trajectory. These are two different types or two different ways of doing trajectory. One of them by focusing only on the joint values. In other words, by focusing on the robot values and therefore controlling, in this case, in this particular robot, theta 1, theta 2, theta 3, or if you want, you can just simply call it theta I. So essentially, in joint space motion planning, we essentially do the motion planning through the robot joints. And that would be theta I. Of course, we would have Li if we had linear joints as well. So theta I and Li. Now, Cartesian space motion planning is that doing the same thing, but through the end effectors Cartesian coordinates. So this is basically x, y, z. If you only care about position, but if you want to include the orientation, then you have to put n, o, a as well. Now, you might think, wait a minute, this looks very much like forward kinematics. And you were right. So this is very much similar to working with forward kinematics, while this part right here is very much similar to work with inverse kinematics. However you like to call it, it's fine as long as you understand the meaning of the terminology. Okay, let's move on. So here's an example of, or actually two examples of joint space motion planning. What is that meaning? What does that mean? You see, in this particular example, or in this example right here, example A, we have decided to move the robot by changing the values of alpha and beta, alpha meaning this, the first joint angle, and beta is the second joint angle, through the values you see in the table right here. What was the reason behind it? What was the logic? Don't ask. Just basically, it was decided that we're going to follow this path, this pattern. And as you can see, joint alpha changes in the beginning from 20 to 30 and then stays at 40. It doesn't move any forward. You can actually see that effect here. So this is basically 20 and 10. This is the initial value. So this is 20 degrees, 10 degrees, and then from then on, zero. So nothing happened from there. Okay, or maybe you can say that from here, zero, this is now 20, 10 degrees, and then another 10 degrees. Yeah, this is basically what happened. So this is now 20 because it was zero, then goes to 20. So that's what happened here. Then from 20 to 30, that means it changed by 10. So that's a 10 degrees. And then from 20 to 40, another change by 10. That's another 10 degrees here. Then, as you can see from the rest, there is no changes. So the link doesn't move any forward. Now, looking at angle beta, as you can see that it starts at 30. So right here, this is the beginning. This is 30. And then from here on, now the change is now is 10 degrees here. Another 10 degrees. Basically, it's always going to be 10 degrees as you go along. You got me? So that's essentially what happened in the first particular case. In the second particular case, the situation is slightly different. And we decided to make the changes slightly more uniform, meaning that from here is always 4 degrees different. So this is 4, not 4 degrees. 4, 4, 4, and so on until we get to here. Yeah, if you notice that the starting angle is 20 and the ending angle is 40 here, but we also get the same thing here. So this is also 20 and this is also 40, right? But then the difference is how you change from the beginning until the end. The same thing here, this is also 30 and we end up with 80, just like the beginning there, the case. And I think this is exactly the same. Yeah, this particular beta angle and the transition from the starting point to the end point does not change. Basically, here we decided to increment by 10, and here we decided to increment by 4. But over here, it's also plus 10, but over here, the increment is not fixed. It's basically custom. We go 10, 10, and then we stop. I mean, so 0 until end. So this is how we actually, in other words, in both of the cases of this robot, we have position A and position B. But we can see that the resulting path of the robot, the way that the robot traveled is different because we have controlled the angles, we have incremented the angles differently. See here, when we incremented the robot, when we incremented the angles in this particular pattern, right, you can see that the resulting travel or the resulting robot path is basically is this path right here. And as you can see, this, by the way, is not a straight line, it's a little bit of curve. As you can see, that is different from this path right here, which is, looks like a little bit more uniform. You know what I mean? So once again, this is how, or this is what happens when you work with joint space, when you control, or when you change the path of the robot, or the travel, the way the robot travels from the beginning until end, by simply controlling the joint angles. Okay. Now, as you can see, no matter what you do in case one or case A or case B, the resulting path will always be a chopped path, meaning basically a series of straight lines and also an increments of straight lines between A and B. I think that's mentioned, yeah, in the next line. As you can see, right, although it might appear a bit more uniform, especially in this case, case number B, right, the path of the end vector, is, as you can see, is not straight. It's not straight line. It's basically a series of straight lines chopped, as you can see from here. Although this looks a little bit more curvious, but more, maybe more uniform, but this is still a series of straight lines, and like it appears to be segmented, and the changes of the angle is actually it's also happening. This could be enough for you. This could be sufficient, but at some point you will see that this is not enough. Now this is an example of, or two other examples of Cartesian space, meaning we decide the way that the robot moves based on the coordinates of the end effector. That's how we did it. We did not care about the angles. We simply started from the position of the beginning until the end, and then we decide, we break the path into simple points like that, and we find the corresponding values you see from here, and then we did inverse kinematics, and similarly here as well. As you can see, by simply the difference between here and here is that the increments were different. See, here are more or less uniform increment, but here is not uniform anymore. The point of showing you this example is you can see now the impact of Cartesian space on joint angles. Now, the difference between these two is that you can see that sometimes the changes in angle values could be disruptive. Sometimes the values or the differences in the position are not constant. Maybe here are relatively constant changes, but over here we have not constant. This is a very high change compared to a relatively slower change, and here is also could be very even slower change. But this higher change in position could also result in even higher changes in velocity, and which will also correspond to even higher changes or differences in acceleration, which again could result in massive forces and actuator failure. So that is why whether you do it directly from the joint space or the Cartesian space, you may not always find the answer. The answer could end up coming from polynomials. And a polynomial is a mathematical equation that is, we love it in mathematics because it can be easily derived, and therefore we can easily work with a family of equations along with their derivatives. So this is not a mathematical course. I'm sure you are familiar with the concept of polynomial equation. If not, maybe you can just Google it a little bit more. Maybe I'll share a link to a description on this, but I'm sure you guys can Google this one out. Now, let's see about this situation that we have in front of us. We have a starting point and we have an ending point. And we have two points of interest. Let's just say this is the start of the motion and this is the end of the motion. And these two points actually correspond to the robot positions or the robot configurations we've seen earlier. You see, the start point actually corresponds to this robot configuration, which itself is defined by the values you see here. So the starting point actually is a set of values that correspond to robot configuration. And the end point is also correspond to another set of values that correspond to the end robot configuration, okay? So now you have two configurations, one for the start, one for the end, and these points right here represent the start and the point. Now we want to know right now is what happens, I think I missed one slide. Yeah, the point is right now is what happens in between? I would like to travel from here to here, but then what happens at this point, for example, or here? What is actually the corresponding values for, the angles versus in between? You might be thinking, okay, a straight line is the answer, right? We could just move the point along the straight lovely line, and we have the coordinates of every point. We just do inverse kinematics, and we have the answer. Okay, this might work, but this would also work. I could, somebody else could decide to move the robot along a curve like this, and we could do the same thing. Find the corresponding coordinates here, then using the coordinates, you can then do inverse kinematics and find the corresponding robot configuration. How about this one? This would also work. Assuming for a minute that you have an obstacle, you don't want the robot hand to come to a certain area within the workspace, maybe because you know that this is where the human hand will be, or the operator will be. So you don't want the robot to hit the person. So you would basically make the robot travel this path. Maybe you would define an intermediate point, and then you would basically make the robot travel along this path. So in all of these cases, there's no right or wrong answer. They're all correct and they're all not correct. In other words, that this could be valid, this could be valid, it could be valid. It depends on the situation. So this one brings us to the same equation. How do we increment the joint angles that would respond or will correspond to the required changes in the pose? From the start to the finish. Even if, let's say we do this, let's say we find the point from here, and we find this here, but then that again, we're gonna bring us the same problem. What happens in between, right? So it's the same thing here. Even if let's say we define the values and we do inverse schematics here, we do inverse schematics here, then what about in between? Okay, again, we're going to end up with the same process. You cannot just put infinite number of points here because that will cause or will result in a huge amount of calculation loading on the processor. So again, that could cause a problem. You would want a way, or we need a way to sort of to model the relationship without having to do inverse kinematics every micromillimeter. So again, the challenge again is not just positional. It's also involved acceleration and velocities. We just talked about this, that this is not about path planning, but it's about trajectory. And trajectory also include timing, because it's also going to affect the velocities and acceleration. You know, the changes in position through time essentially is velocity. And the changes in velocity through time is essentially is acceleration. And we just talked about the effect of acceleration and velocities on the dynamics. They will change forces as well as energies. So that's why we want these two velocities and accelerations to be minimal as well. So we need a mathematical model that will actually help us to develop some sort of formulas or, you know, motion formulas or equations that will also put into consideration angles, positions, velocities, and acceleration. And if you're thinking about it, yes, we have done something like this in the past. For those who are doing mechanical engineering, taking this course right now, then you would recognize this from theory of machine. I do actually teach Tom. I mean, I did in the past, but not anymore. I think I taught Tom for 5 years. And in chapter 8, I think, when we did CAM design, we came up with the same, or we arrived at the same problem. We want to design the CAM, or the transition from the CAM, from one position or one displacement to another. That's the meaning of the letter S here, displacement. This is the displacement from one displacement to another, while managing the velocity change, velocity changes, acceleration changes, as well as the jerk, which is the derivative of the acceleration over time, or how the acceleration itself is changing through time. So we want to find the model that helped us to find, and these are not polynomial, these are actually sinusoidal equations, if you remember. But then these are also similar method. They are also trying to solve the same problem. It's trying to find a model that can actually help us to model this motion or to control this motion by putting into mind all of these elements together, the S, V, A, J, which is the displacement, velocity, acceleration, and jerk into the motion. And that's why we used at that time the third order as well as the fifth order polynomial. And at the time, if you remember, so that's how we apply the third order. I hope you remember why we had two versions of the polynomial. I hope if you don't, the reminder is coming soon. But that basically we will see in a few slides from now. So coming back to our robot example, basically it's the same idea. We have two positions, starting and ending, and we need to sort of create a model of motion that put into consideration the changes in position, in this case theta, as well as angular position theta dot, as well as angular acceleration theta double dot, or if you'd like, this is alpha or omega, and this is alpha. And so therefore, you would want to put a model that puts into consideration all of these motions or all of the kinematics at the same time. And that brings us to trajectory planning, third polynomial. And I think this is already the procedure. So the third order polynomial is going to be used when we have four boundary conditions. There is a formula for that, is that the number of order is equal to the number of boundary conditions minus one. So four boundary conditions minus one gives us the order that you need. I think, yeah. So order equal to boundary condition minus one. That's the formula. So four boundary condition minus one gives us third order polynomial. So these are the four boundary conditions that we have. The position at the start, which is at t equal to zero, and the position at the end. And this one is readily available to us because we already have the position at the start and the position at the end. Okay, what's next? What's next is that we need the velocity at the start and the velocity at the end as well. We could define a specific value right here and a specific value right here. And that will be our, actually, we're really going to do that. We're going to define a certain velocity at the beginning and a velocity at the end. And that will be our third and fourth boundary conditions. Then, once we have these four boundary conditions, then the motion or the motion of joint number one or theta one, essentially, not just theta one, could be any theta, by the way, will then will be defined using this equation, which is the value of the position will equal to C0 until the end, as you can see, until the t to the power 3 or t cubed. And this structure you see right here essentially is the polynomial equation with time as the variable and with four coefficients. C values you see in front of you are the coefficients. And by the way, I'm not teaching polynomials here. I'm just revising. So once again, if you do not remember or do not understand what is polynomials, I suggest you stop this video now and Google the concept of on polynomial, or you can take a look at the link in the description and watch that video or read that article first, and then come back at this point. Okay, but again, since you are this course is an elective course and you already passed on a couple of years ago, so you should remember the polynomial if you paid attention back then. Okay, so now we are here. So the values of the coefficient or ci or basically coefficients 0, 1, 2, 3 until the end, right, are depend on the boundary conditions. So the way you're going to find them actually is dependent on the boundary conditions. Now, even though that we considered only position and only velocities, we can still solve and find for the acceleration, even though that it was not part of the boundary conditions. I will leave this for you to think about is how do we do that? Once again, this should not be a difficult workout for you because you have already seen how polynomials work in theory of machine. Okay, fifth order. Now, if you are already familiar with third order or if you have already solved examples on third order, then transitioning to fifth order will be pretty much straightforward. It just is going to be more work, more calculations, but the procedure is more or less the same. So for now, because we have six boundary conditions, we will need the fifth order. Again, the formula that we've seen earlier here applies, which is the order of the polynomial equal to bc minus 1, or the boundary conditions minus 1. So here we have six boundary conditions minus 1. That gives us fifth order polynomial. So now these are now the boundary conditions. But now we're going to involve the position as well as the accelerations into our analysis. And you need six values, three for the starting and three for the ending. That will give us the six boundary conditions that we'll need. And then we will use it to find the values. And by the way, this was a typo. I think this two, it's not necessarily or limited to just theta one. This could be any theta or any joint. I think when I was making the slide, I forgot to remove this number one here, but it's actually any joint or any angle for any joint. So it's not necessarily limited to just theta number one. All right, so let's just put that note somewhere. Okay, and similarly, the equation of the position of this joint essentially again is defined or using the fifth order polynomial, which it ends at power to the power of 5, and again we have six boundary conditions. So 1, 2, 3, 4. Essentially, they start counting from 0, so there are 6 C's. But the procedure is exactly the same as a third order polynomial. A little bit more work, but it's exactly the same process. Using the boundary conditions, solve and find the coefficients and find the constant values. Then the value of the coefficients, yes, which is the C values, depend on the boundary conditions. Okay. So once you have, now there is a difference between them. I'll give you a moment to think about it and try to remember what is the difference between, apart from difficulty, what is the reason why we come to third order polynomial. You see, let me explain what's the purpose of this question. You see, both of these two powers, whether it's third order or fifth order, they're both going to give you the kinematics, meaning they're both going to provide you with position, velocity, and acceleration. And this one too, position, velocity, and acceleration. Position, velocity, and acceleration. So what is the difference between them? Okay, I'll give you a moment to think about it. You can pause and think about it. Okay, so the difference between them is that here, although the third order polynomial gives us acceleration, We did not include acceleration in the analysis itself. If you go back to this previous slide, you will see that although we can find the acceleration from here, and by the way, the answer to this question is simple, is that once you develop the formula or the equation for velocity, right, you just differentiate this one with respect to time, you will get the formula for acceleration. It's that simple. So once you develop the expression for velocity in terms of time, then just differentiate that with respect to time, you will get the acceleration formula, okay? So the difference now is that either, now here we start with values or the correlation. Now the difference between the third order and the fifth order, you see, although both of them, they give you kinematics, we did not include acceleration in the analysis. So as a result, you might end up with problems here. Meaning you might end up with a situation that although the values of the acceleration could be found, but it could be still causing you problem. You could end up with sudden shifts of acceleration. You might end up, if you're not careful, let me try to draw it over here. Yeah. So over here, your acceleration diagram might look like this if you're not careful, like this, and then suddenly like this within the range of the angle. So although the values of acceleration here and here is fine, but then suddenly you have a change in acceleration, a huge magnitude of change, but then with zero amount of time. You see, remember, velocity, yeah? This could happen in velocity, yeah? So if you remember dv over d time, time essentially is the changes in velocity over time. So if we have a big change in velocity, as you can see here, but the time is almost zero, this could end up almost equal to acceleration equal to infinity, or very, very, very high amount of acceleration. And that could translate in real life into very, very high amount of forces and torques. So that is why using third order polynomial, yes, easier, but then not safe, we should say. That is why the fifth order polynomial is safer, because you would incorporate the values of the accelerations a lot more safer compared to the fifth order polynomial. You would not end up with this situation because you've already accounted for acceleration changes beforehand. So that's why pros and cons. Yeah, third order is easier, but then could still result in problems. Fifth order is a little bit more difficult, but then more accurate. Now, of course, when I say difficult or more difficult, I'm talking about if you want to do it by hand. But of course, if you use MATLAB or any software, then of course you should go for fifth order, because you will not be doing the labor work yourself. MATLAB or any software you develop will do the hard work for you. Okay. Okay, last part before we begin the exercise. Okay, so regardless whether it's third order or fifth order, the procedure is usually the same. This is the third order example, and this is the fifth order. And I think this time I properly removed the 1, 1 from here. So whether it's third order or fifth order, the very first step is important. Based on the given information, aka the boundary conditions, you will then determine the power that you need, whether it's third order or fifth order. Basically, if you were given four information or four boundary conditions, then we are here. But if you were given six information or six boundary conditions, then you are here. So based on that, you will know which equation are you working with. Is it third order, which is this example right here, or third order, or fifth order, okay? So you know which one are you working with. Second step, okay, after you determine the power and the version of the polynomial you're going to be working with, then you're going to use those boundary conditions to find the coefficients. And this is essentially a matter of using algebra, really. You will have equal amount of equation, equal amount of unknowns, just solve and end up. Now, the difference between this, between third and fourth, is right here. You see, in the third order, when you actually come here, you will end up with a 2x2 system. Third order, yeah. You will end up with a 2x2 system. What does that mean? Basically, two equations and two unknowns. So obviously, this is relatively easier to solve. But in a fifth order polynomial, right? And in a fifth order, you will end up with a 3x3 system of equation. So you will have essentially, this is terrible, okay. You will have three equations and three unknowns, which is still doable, but then again, you will need more time if you're doing it by hand or using a calculator. But of course, both of these situations are easy if you're doing using software. Now, if you're doing a test on paper, then obviously you will do it by hand or using a calculator. So you need to put this into consideration. I mean, when it comes to time consuming, when the time management and stuff. Of course, calculators can sometimes help you. Some calculators can help you to just plug in the values and then it will find the solutions for you. You might want to learn more about your calculator. Okay, so once you develop the coefficients, and then what? But then once you develop the coefficients, you can just plug them in here, and then you can develop the equations where the only variable will be the time variable, and that will be the equations that we are talking about here. Let me clean up a little bit here. So let's just move this extra line. Yeah. So essentially, once you find the values for coefficients, then you can then develop the equations for the kinematics. We can call these, we can sometimes call these equations the kinematics equations. The kinematics, obviously, because they involve position, velocity, and acceleration. So kinematics equations, right? Then, of course, that means only function of time. So there's no other variables here, so simply function of time only. Okay, so once you have the formulas in terms of time only, then we know that we are done. Then next, once you're done, then you can simply plot using a predetermined time step. A time step essentially is, when you actually start the procedure, you must have a starting and ending point. So what does that mean? The analysis will be limited. So let's say, from t is equal to 0 to t is equal to, say, 3. So all the analysis that we're going to be doing here, all of these steps right here, right, it will be based on the situation from time equal to 0 to time equal to 3 seconds. So when you want to find some values or you want to do some plotting, you want to jump from 0 to 3, but you want to do some sort of an interval, like sort of a, an increment. So that is usually defined using a time step. A time step essentially could be, let's say, 0.5 seconds. So that means you're going to start from 0, then 0.5, then 1.0, then 1.5, and so on until you get to 3.0. Okay? And then, so therefore, that's what you mean by you can then use the equation and the plot, find the values based on the time step. So the time step in this case will be the value of 0.5. So in this particular example, the time step we defined was the value of 0.5. Maybe somebody we don't want to go for 0.5. They want to use 1 as the time step. So in this case, we'll go from 0, 1, and then 2, and then straight away to 3. So this is the difference. Of course, the smaller the time step, the more accurate the diagram would be. But again, the more work you'll have to do in calculation and in plotting. But again, it's as long as you have the equations ready, then it's just a matter of routine, really. You have the equations, just plug them in and we're good to go. Then you can use the plots and equations to find the kinematics values for the joint at any given instant. Once you have the plot, the diagram, and once you have the formula, then you can then find it to find any instant in between. And that actually is the solution to our problem. You see, if I actually already have the starting here and here, so I don't really need points in between. I would straight away develop a formula or a formula that will give me a curve. So this curve right here is not defined by individual points and then I have to do inverse kinematics. No, the formula itself for this curve will be given to me. So essentially the analysis that we can do, the trajectory analysis, here. So I don't have to actually do this step. I don't have to define these individual points, find their original their coordinates, and then do inverse kinematics. No, all I really don't need to do any of that. All I really have to do is do this trajectory analysis, and boom, I will have a formula function that will define this curve right here. So therefore, the formula is available. Now, at this point, at any instant along the curve, of course, my current curve you see in front of you is very ugly, but you get the idea. It will be a very smooth line. And then at any point or at any instant in between, you can then find the value or the corresponding value of the joint. And similarly, we can then take this formula and then plug it into the controller, which will then be used to basically control the motion. So rather than going point by point, we will simply give the formula into the controller as a controlling algorithm, and then that then will control the motion from the start until the end point, and also through the proper time. So from t equal to 0, which is at the start, until t equal to final, which is at the end. So this is what I mean by trajectory analysis using polynomial. Okay? Where are we? We are here. Okay. So and we talked about this, and now finally we do exercise. So we're going to go with this last exercise, or this exercise, and then basically we will be done with this session for today. It's about, yeah, it's under an hour so far, so I think by the time we finish with this exercise, we'll be finished already. So let's take a look. So again, when you read this question, if you have done theory of machine, then this question will look and sound very familiar to you. The third, just some of the words will be different, but the values and the numbers will be very, very familiar to you. So this is the fourth joint of the 6 degrees of freedom manipulator. The fourth joint of a 6 degree rhythm is at 70 degrees at the start of the work cycle, okay? It is then increased by 30 degrees in 30 seconds, okay? In a rest-to-rest motion. I hope now you remember what this means. Using the third order polynomial, although this is redundant, but the question is clearly telling you what polynomial to use, develop the trajectory for this joint. Straight away, right there. And when we say develop the trajectory means all of this, means find the equations, develop the formulas, plot, and so on and so forth. So, but again, because this is an exercise, so the question is giving you even more specifics. Specifically, develop using the given boundary condition, find the coefficients or the constant values, and then determine the kinematics values at a time using a time step of 1 second. So let's see. So it's from zero until for 3 seconds. So you have t is equal to zero. So t is equal to one because it's after one time step, and then the second time step would be two here. Yep, and then finally t will be equal to three. So these are the values. So when they say find the kinematics values using this time step, basically means find the values of theta, theta dot, and theta double dot at this time. And repeat the process for all of these three values at all of these times. Okay? So that's essentially what the meaning of find the kinematic values using this time step. Then, once you have those nice values, then the point of plotting becomes straightforward. So once you have the values, then essentially you can simply just plot them as usual. So let's say this was theta, and this was time. So you have, let's just say this is time and this is theta. So very ugly, very big theta, right? So this will be 0, 1, and this is 2, and this is 3, which is the starting and ending. And then you already have the values, remember, from here. So it's just a matter of now plotting. So you have one value here, one value here, one value here, and then you can just use by hand, and that will be the plot for position. Similarly, the process is repeated for acceleration and velocity, and then you'll have the drawings on you, or the plottings for velocity and acceleration. So what about jerk, which is the derivative of acceleration? No, we don't need it. For robotics, or at least for now, we don't need it. But if we did need it, we just have to differentiate the acceleration equation and repeat the process. But for now, we don't need it. So now here we are. So essentially, I'm moving forward too fast. So this is the question, okay? So now, how do you do it? So once again, I'll give you a moment, or I'll give you a chance to pause this video and try and solve this question on your own using the memories that you have from theory of machine. If you are a mechanical engineering student, because this video is meant for mechanical engineering students, and you know what I'm talking about, you might want to refresh from your TOM notes. So essentially, go ahead and pause this video and then solve and find the values and the trajectory for based on the questions or based on the information given to you in the problem statement. By the time I finish cleaning this slide, I'm going to move on to the next one. So if you want, you can pause right now, and I'll give you a moment to fix it, to try to do it yourself. Otherwise, by the time I finish cleaning this slide, I'm going to move on to the next slide, which shows the solution. Okay, this is too much, so I'm going to move on now. Okay, so now this is the solution. The very first step is that since the question clearly told you to use, or simply made it easier for you instructed you to use the third order polynomial, so straight away go ahead and use it. So the third order polynomial, this is supposed to be, the question said fourth joint, so you cannot use theta 1 because I copy-pasted this from somewhere, so that's why I'm getting 1 here. By right, this should be 4. And this time we have to use 4 is because the question clearly says the fourth joint. This used to be 4, 4, and 4, okay? So this is the value C1, and this is basically now the third order polynomial right here. This is now third order. And if you take this equation and differentiate it with respect to time, you will get here. Why? Because that's the beauty of the polynomial equation, and that's why we are using it now, which is the simplicity of differentiation and integration as well. Do this one more time, and you get the equation for acceleration. Now, sir, did we need this bar right here? No, we didn't, because the boundary condition is only for position and velocity. But if you want, you can just use this. You can just do it now. Might as well, I mean. Okay, so now that we've done the very first step, which is developing the equations for alpha, I mean theta, alpha, and omega. Okay, what's next? Next, we need to now apply the boundary condition. And this right here, you know what? I'm gonna keep. So I'm gonna go back here and I'm gonna animate this part a little bit. So this one, and I'm gonna go to animation, fade, and make it fast. And also with previous and make it faster. And same thing for those guys. Now you're watching how I animate my slides. Hopefully you learn something from this one as well. Okay, so bit of housekeeping here. So this one right here, I'm gonna change it to on click. And this one right here is gonna be on click. And the last one will be on click as well. And I think that's sufficient. So let's go now to slideshow, continue. So now, now that we have developed the equations, what are we going to do with them? So now we need to solve the equations using the boundary conditions. So now we're going to begin with the very first boundary condition, which is we're going to apply it. We have four boundary conditions, which is position and acceleration. See, we do have the value for the starting value of theta, which is right here at 70. And then let me just switch on the pen. Yeah. So we have the value for theta, the position value, which is 70, which is right here. This is what's going on at this boundary condition. What this statement right here says is that the value of theta 4 at the start of the time, or at the initial time, and that's exactly is stated in the question. At the start of the working cycle, the value of the angle is 70. So that's what we got here. But then we already know that that also equal to this whole thing right here, this whole equation. So that's how we have this situation. Now you have to remember that in order for you to get 70, the value of t is must equal to zero. So you can then use this equation t. We just plug in the value of time at the start, which is time equal to zero. So we just simply plug in 0, 0, 0. And similarly here, so now we have the value for acceleration. And again, this is 4. So in the beginning, we know that at the beginning of the velocity is zero. It's already given to us in the question. How did we do that? You should know it by now, but it's right here. It's from rest to rest. Meaning, at the start of the point, the value of the velocity or the object was not moving. It was basically a constant. It was resting. Resting means it's not moving. In other words, velocity is zero. And then again, since this is the value for t, right here, this is the value for t, so t is equal to zero. Therefore, we just substitute the value for t here. And as again, the same thing here, as we did already here. Now, t to the power, since t is equal to 0, obviously, so this is 0, this is 0, this is 0. So 0 multiplied by everything, this also goes away, goes away, goes away. So we are left with just t, these two values. That gives us straight away the first two coefficients, c0 and c1. So henceforth, c1 is 0 and c0 is 70. Now, you can straight away go back here and straight away drop or throw away these two values because C1 is 0. That actually simplifies the procedure later on. So, moving forward, so now apply the boundary conditions on the final values right here. So, again, we do the same thing. Again, the position of theta 4, which is again given to us in the question, says increased by 30 degrees. So it did not become 30, it increased by 30. So the final value is 70, which is the starting value, plus the increase, which is 30. So that's why we get 100 here. And then when does that happen, which is at t is equal to final, okay, which is equal to 3, sorry? So we take the value for 3 and we just plug it in here. So that will give us 3 and 3 and 3. Is that right? And the same thing here. So again, rest to rest means, again, at the end is also resting. So it means the velocity at the end is also 0, which also means that when the time is equal to final, it's also equal to 0. That means the position, or excuse me, the velocity was also equal to 0. So again, this is now t is equal to 3, and this t is equal to 3. So then we need to now simplify this equation. At first glance, this looks complicated and scary, but you have to remember that c1 is actually 0 from right here. You have to remember that. So then we can simplify this equation greatly by doing so. Oh no, I think I made a typo. Oh no, no, it's not a typo. So then basically now you have to remember also that c0 is actually equal to 70. So you have to plug it into the equation. What I did here is that I simply do two steps in one. I put 70 here, so this is 70. And 3 to the power of 2, that will be 9. And then 3 to the power of 3, that will be 27. And then 70 goes to the other side. So 100 minus 70 gives us 30. See here. So now this is what happened in equation. So now after we clean up this equation a little bit, so this becomes equation number 1. Do the same thing for equation number 2. You'd end up with this equation. And now this is now our second. These are our first and second equation. This is what I meant by a 2 by 2 equation. Two equations multiplied by two variables, in this case C2 and C3. We can then solve and find these two equations. That will give us the values of C2 and C3. Let me just clean up a little bit. So then we can get the values of C2 is equal to 10, and the value of C3 is equal to negative 2.2, and that gives us the coefficient. So this is basically what I meant by using the boundary condition to solve for coefficients. By the way, this is also a refresher in case you forgot how to work with differential equations. So now moving on. Now, taking the coefficients that you have found, now remember, the equations originally look like this, with all of C1, C2s, and all of the C values. Now they have developed the values for coefficients, or the value of the C's, right? We just then plug them into the equations, and then the equations will look like this. So right here, these three sets of equations are now called the kinematics equations. Because right here, these are now the three equations that define the position, orientation, the position and velocity and acceleration of the joint number 4. And again, let me make this quick correction here. This is supposed to be 4, not 1. This is a small typo. So then, essentially, these are the equations, or if you want, you can call it theta, which is the position, and omega and alpha, but for joint number 4. And as you can see, is defined as a function of time only, meaning the only variable we have now left is just the time. There's no other variable, no other coefficient, nothing. And then from here on in, it's just a matter of substitution and plotting. Really, they're basically based on the values, because the time step given to us was equal to 1, so here's are the values of the time that correspond to us. We just plug them into this equation. So when t is equal to 0, this is going to be a 0, this is going to be a 0, 0, 0, so we're going to end up with the initial values. You should verify them. And similarly for velocity, and similarly for acceleration. By the way, if you actually plug t is equal to 0 here, you're going to end up with the initial acceleration of 20, right from the beginning. That acceleration straight away is equal to 20. So this could be good, this could not be, this could be good, and this could be bad. And I will show you, if you plot these diagrams, right? I don't have diagrams in my slides, but I'm going to show you how roughly the diagrams will look like. So the position will change from 70 to 100. So roughly speaking, this is going to look like, this is, ignore that this is a 0. I'll just say that this is a 70 and this is 100. So this is the position diagram. And if I change the color a little bit, so now, the angular the velocity will change from 0 to 0. So that will look like this. So again, ignore the horizontal scale, whatever, but it will look like this. So you're going to end up from a 0 and end up with a 0, and then, let me rewind a little bit. Make this, I know for sure how the diagram will look like, so I'm going to plot it properly. So, once again, pen, and also The color of the pen is red. Okay, right here. So let's say that this is now the time, and this is now theta, omega, and alpha. Okay, so the value for theta is changing from 70 to 100. So let's just say that this is 70 and this is now 100. Okay, so this is now 70 and this is 100. And then omega will basically will be changing. Remember that omega or the velocity is rest to rest. So you're going to end up with a zero value right here. It's going to go to a maximum and then go to zero, zero here again, right? But then take a look at what's going to happen to the acceleration. At t equal to zero, which is right here, you're going to end up with the acceleration of equal to 20 right here, or somewhere around here. And then at the end, it's going to end up with negative 20 as well at the end. So because it's accelerating here, as you can see that, if you look at the velocity diagram, and you can see that the velocity is increasing, is that right? So definitely we will have a positive acceleration here. And then we're going to end up with zero acceleration here, then we're going to end up with negative acceleration because it's decelerating, as you can see from here. Okay? Ignore this other point. All right, so what's the big deal? You can see that the cycle of this whole thing actually is now happens at this point. But what happens now is that when you start the cycle again, let's say the robot motion is doing this in a cyclic behavior, we can end up with this behavior of the acceleration that looks like this. So now you have a jump or a sudden change in acceleration in zero time. And you have to remember that this acceleration corresponds to a certain force, and this acceleration corresponds to a certain force. So the change in acceleration will result in change in forces, in a very, very rapid change in forces. That could result in a catastrophic failure to the actuator. So that is why sometimes it's not a good idea to do third order polynomial, because the third order polynomial does not consider what happens to the acceleration. So that is why, as an exercise, I want you to repeat the same exercise, the same question right here, but rather than using third order, use fifth order and repeat the process yourself. If you don't want to do the manual work, which I suggest you do, but if you really do want to do the labor work, simply use a program, write it in MATLAB, or use it in your calculator or whatever, but then essentially see then the difference in the plots, then you'll see the difference or the impact on of the fourth or the third order and the fourth order. Finally, this is the last couple of slides now. This is a different exercise, different workout. I suggest you do it twice, once for third order and then fifth order. And it's really it. It's just a different example. That's all. It's a different example, I suggest, with that solution this time. So I suggest that you do it directly using twice, solve it using third order and then fifth order, and then compare the difference in between them. Of course, when the object is resting, the acceleration must be also, the object is not moving, so it must have an acceleration of zero. This could be something that actually made you think a little bit. You see, what is it? Yeah, right here we said that the acceleration is, the motion of the object is rest to rest. Is that right? We said that this is rest to rest, means the object in the end is not even moving, or the robot joint is not moving. It's actually constant, yet the acceleration in the end or the beginning are not constant, are not zero. You know what I mean? So that again gives us a little bit of problem. So that is why you should get you should use the fifth order polynomial. And I can tell you the fifth order polynomial, the diagrams will be slightly different. You will end up with a situation like this. So this is the position 70 to 100 as usual, 70 to 100. The position or the velocity again will change as before, right? But then the acceleration again, you should end up with a situation like this. And the situation is also like that. So again, you will have the velocity not going to be very high step or sudden changes, but then it will be cyclic. So even if, let's say, we repeat this motion in cycles, then the cycle will not going to be interrupted, so it should be no problem. So this is the impact of the fifth order versus third order. So that's it. We have done, as I told you before, this session is relatively smaller compared to the others. We have essentially completed now the analysis on trajectory planning. One other thing, like I said, this is only for one joint. We have just working with one individual joint. But in a real robot, we will, after we finish the analysis on one joint, we'll have to move on to the other joints. So basically, we'll have to repeat the process, whether it's third order or fifth order for joint one, joint two, joint three, and so on, until we develop a set of equations for each joint, and then we will then feed the controller all of these equations for each individual joint. But of course, there is no point of repetition here, so if you know how to do this for one individual joint, then you can do the same thing for each joint. So that is why we will stop right here, and we will not do a robot-based trajectory analysis. We will simply stop at a single joint analysis. So essentially, this is it. We have learned some, we have talked about some terminologies, and then we did some kind of analysis. Familiarity with, if you are already familiar with the theory of machine concept in CAM chapters, and that will help you. If not, you can then familiarize yourself with the polynomials in description, in the link that I shared in the description, as well as through the example that I went through, and hopefully that will be useful for you. Now, what's the point of all of this? What was the purpose of developing all of these equations? I think I'm going to jump to the end to answer this one. So once again, the purpose of developing those equations is that we will develop a formula or a function that defines the motion of the robot from one point to the other while considering its position, velocity and accelerational changes. So that then gives us the best. We were confused when we were moving from one point to another. Should we use a straight line? Should we use a curve? Should we do a complicated curve? Or how do we go about it? And then the trajectory analysis simply answers this by providing us with a curve, directly curve, without having to know the individual points in between. And not only that, this curve provides us with a motion of the joint in terms of time, but it also gives us the same equation, or it also does the same thing while considering velocity and accelerations as well. So that means that the motion will be timed, and therefore it will be within the safety requirements of the robot itself. Okay, so I hope that with this we are now completed our kinematics in general. And if you remember, the very purpose of robot kinematics was actually to do this, is that you have a robot and you would like to program it. You would like this robot is connected to a controller, and this controller is controlled, or is, you know, can be given instructions through a program. And in this program, you will need to tell the controller what to do. So this controller would require some algorithms or some functions. And those functions, how do we get them, was through kinematics. So this is now, hopefully now, you will see the whole point of doing kinematics, be it forward kinematics, inverse kinematics, as well as trajectory analysis. The procedure essentially is the same. First, by doing the kinematics operation, we will develop the formulas. Once we develop the formulas, we can then write them in our program. Then in our program, then can be then used to control the controller, which then results in the motion of the robot to essentially to perform the motion that we want from the beginning. So of course, our kinematics will be based on requirements, like certain changes. You want the robot to travel along a certain path, or you want the robot to move from a specific point to the another. So these are the things you define. So best after you define the motion itself, you then go to kinematics. Okay, this last part was ugly. So let me fix that one. So essentially, the complete sequence, the hopefully now you can get the whole picture. So so we start from here. This is where you begin. You have an industrial robot that you would like the robot to do a certain motion. So you have the robot and it's right here, and you want it to move from this configuration to this configuration, for example. And you want the robot to travel from this configuration to the other, maybe back and forth, let's say like in a sequence of motions. So you already define, the boundary condition. You define the position and orientation or the poses from the beginning and the start. And then you take this information and you feed it into your kinematics analysis. That will then, in turn, will provide you with the formulas that you will need in order to those formulas that will govern the motion of the individual joints of the robot. These formulas, in turn, can be then fed into the program. And once they are in the program and then given the right values of the parameters, which once again given from here, then you can then use it to control the robot. Then the robot can then perform the motion that you wanted it in the first place. So kinematics, in generally speaking, kinematics are the key element that is missing for between what you want the robot to do and then the robot actually doing it. So hopefully by now you'll get the whole picture into what robot kinematics is and its purpose and why did we use it. It's extensive, it's nearly 5 weeks, but then we needed to go through this whole process to understand how it works. Again, the robot frame matrix, transformations, forward kinematics, inverse kinematics, and then trajectory analysis. They were all part of one unit called kinematics. Of course, in this particular course, we also missed some elements out, like the DH approach. We did not really do it. So as of now, if you're in a course, you are limited to a specific number of robots. But if you are interested, then wait for my video on the DH, which I will do later on. But it's not part of the syllabus, but it's for your general purposes only. But if you learn the DH approach, then you can do any customized industrial robot. And the reason why we did not include it in the course is because the chances of you working with a customized industrial robot are very slim. Most of the time, your company will buy one of the industrial robots or one of the planar robots that we talked about. So that is why the chances of you doing a customary or a customized analysis are very slim, unless you are designing the robot yourself. The chances of you working with or designing the robot yourself right after graduation are very slim. So that's why I wanted you to focus only, or in the beginning at least, on standard robots like Cartesian, spherical, and cylindrical, and then of course the planar robots. Okay, so with this, we are done with kinematics. Starting next week, I think we're gonna have the test and then followed by the break, and then after that, we're gonna start to focus on robot control. So I'll see you in the later sessions in the next video. So thank you and take care.